I'd like to talk to you now about the ticking of your biological clock and what you can do to preserve your fertility. You know, in the modern era that we live in right now, most women prefer to put off childbearing until they're in their late 20s, their mid-30s, maybe even their early 40s. In the old days, we used to get pregnant when we were in our late teens or early 20s, and infertility was not a huge problem. But right now, infertility is a gigantic worldwide epidemic, and mostly because our life is so complicated and so enriched these days we really aren't ready to have children until we're older, and by then we have to worry about our biological clock ticking away, and will we be able to have children in our later years when we want children, in our late 20s or in our 30s? What can we do to protect ourselves from becoming part of the infertility statistic that's just rampant worldwide? So I'm going to show you, a series of slides and images and even some videos to talk about this, because you can solve this problem. You can preserve your fertility and save your fertility for a much later date. So first, let me tell you about the infertility epidemic, and it's worldwide, almost in every developed or developing country, in U.S., in Europe, China, India, all over the world. The number one reason for going to see a doctor for a new doctor visit is infertility, not heart disease or diabetes or lung disease, but simply infertility. It's just absolutely incredible. And this has all occurred in the last 40 years. In fact, about 25% of all women of childbearing age who currently want to have a child are infertile. So, in fact, I'll quote here from an article I just wrote, "The real reason for the anticipated insolvency of Social Security in the United States is that although people are living to an older age, many are not having children." So infertility is a raging epidemic that is not only a threat to individuals who want to have children, but it's a threat to the well-being of our entire society, not just to those couples that desperately want to have children. So the major reason for this worldwide infertility epidemic, and I'm going to go into that now if you'll just look at these slides with me. Let's look at what the incidence of infertility is according to the age of the wife. Now, in her early 20s, about 1% of women are infertile. For teenagers, it's even less than 1%. But by the time you're in your late 20s, 16% of women are infertile. Now, most women who decide to have children these days, say at age 28, figure they're beating their biological clock because they're going to go ahead and try to have children before they hit their 30s, and they figure that they have maybe a head up on girlfriends who really aren't interested in trying to have children until they're in their 30s. But the truth is that you already have a 16-fold drop in fertility by the time you're in your late 20s from when you were in your early 20s. Now, when you're in your mid-30s, almost 25% of women are infertile. And actually, if you just look at this chart, this is a term I won't necessarily bring up now called aneuploidy, but the point is that there is a relationship between the woman's age, the chance of her being infertile, the risk of having a miscarriage when she does get pregnant, and in fact the risk of having that terrible dilemma of having a child with Down syndrome, which all women in their late 30s who get pregnant worry about. And if you look at the chart, what you realize is that infertility and even miscarriage is very uncommon in women that are in their late teens or early 20s. But as you hit age 30, already 16% of women are infertile, and almost 15% of pregnancies end in miscarriage. And then by the time you're 40, about 30% of pregnancies end in miscarriage, and over 50% of women by age 40 are infertile. And then Down syndrome, that's trisomy 21. mental retardation problem. We begin to worry about that at age 35, but it's only about, say, 1 out of 500, but then it goes up so that by the time you're age 45, if you do get pregnant and deliver, there's a 6% chance of that child having Down syndrome. All these phenomena that increase with age are related to the fact that your eggs are getting older as you get older. So what about if we do IVF and we put them through treatment? Even so, you realize that the pregnancy rate goes down even with in vitro fertilization the older you get. And so even if you're able to afford to have in vitro fertilization when you're in your mid-30s or late 30s, by that time, your chance of pregnancy, even with in vitro fertilization, is somewhat lower than when you were younger, say in your early 20s or mid-20s. And the risk of miscarriage goes up as you get older. And all of these graphs are related to changes in the chromosomes of your eggs as you get older. So let me explain this a little more clearly. But of course, first, let me preface it by saying we have a solution to this problem. So I'm painting a dire picture, but I don't want you to be frightened by this picture because we have a solution, a fantastic solution to the problem. But first, I want to make you aware of the problem. So by age 40, about 60% of women are infertile, and by age 43, it would be a rare woman who is still fertile. And this dramatic drop-off in fertility with just moderate increases in age are caused by the aging of the woman's eggs. Now, women would have no difficulty getting pregnant and having children in their 40s or 50s, except simply for the fact that their eggs are older, or they may have even run out of eggs completely. So let me explain that. A woman is normally born with about 2 million eggs, and she's not going to make any more eggs. And by the time she's a teenager, she has about 400,000 eggs left in her ovaries. Now, 1,000 eggs die every month, inexorably. There's nothing you can do to stop that. Taking birth control pills doesn't slow that down, and even taking fertility pills doesn't speed it up. In other words, there is a hormone-independent death of 1,000 eggs every month, or 30 eggs every day, that you can't do anything about. It's just inexorable, you can't help it. So about 13,000 eggs a year die, and you get to ovulate, say, about 400 eggs in your lifetime, and by the time you're in your 40s, you've run out of fertile eggs. So those 400,000 eggs that you had as a teenager are usually depleted by your late 30s or early 40s, and about 10 years later, after you've lost your fertility, that's when you go through menopause. In other words, you still have a few eggs holding on, and you're still menstruating, but you've lost your fertility, and about 10 years later is when you have your menopause, or your change in life, and you stop having periods altogether. Now, this doesn't happen with men, because men keep on producing hundreds of millions of new sperm every day. Men have stem cells in their testicles that make sperm every day. With women, all the eggs that you ever have are what you're born with, and 1,000 of them die every month. So it may seem very unfair biologically, but men continue to be fertile as they get older, but women don't. So there is very little age-related decline in fertility in men. However, in women, there is a dramatic age-related decline in fertility, so that by the time you're in your late 20s, about 16% of women are infertile, and by the time you're in mid-30s, 25% are infertile, and it's only because of the aging of your eggs. But some women will be very fertile when they're 40, or 42 even, and have many eggs, and other women will have run out of their eggs by the time they're 23 or 24 and be infertile in their early 20s. So the question is, where are you on your biological clock? For example, if you're 23 and you were to know that you have so many eggs that you're not going to become infertile until you're 42, you could plan your life with greater assurance and do what you want to do prior to worrying about getting married and having children. But what if you were 23 and you found out you only had a few more years of fertility left? Well, then you'd have to do some careful planning. On the other hand, what if you're 38 and you're very, very concerned because you think you may not be able to have any more children? If you were to know that you're one of those 38-year-olds, that would sure take a lot of pressure and a lot of anxiety off of your living. So, how do we find this out? Before I actually tell you about the testing you can do, which is very cheap and simple, and what you can do to preserve your fertility, I just want to read a little note from my logbooks when I spent some time with the Hadzi Bushmen, a 40,000-year-old Stone Age hunter-gatherer culture in Africa. I'm very fascinated by ancient cultures. So let me read from this. When I lived a short while with the Hadzi Bushmen in the most remote region of Africa, it's a 40,000-year-old Stone Age hunter-gatherer culture, I asked them about infertility, and they had no idea what I was talking about. See, I was an infertility doctor from the United States, and I wanted to know whether infertility, which is a huge plague in the Western world, and in developing Asia, whether this is a problem in an ancient culture such as theirs. I mean, these people would get up at 6:30 in the morning and go hunting and gathering all day long and then go to sleep 6:30 at night when the sun went down, 7 days a week. It's a very, very ancient, basic culture. They had no huts, no place to live, no agriculture, and they didn't have any domesticated animals. But it represents how we lived 40,000 years ago. They're the same as us physically and genetically, but they just have an ancient, undeveloped, so to speak, uncivilized culture. So let me read from this. They could not imagine a woman not becoming pregnant or bearing children. It would be a very, very rare woman with such a curse, they would call it. But the Hadzi get married at age 15, and the average life expectancy is 33. Our biology, our human biology, has not changed in 40,000 years. All that has changed is our culture, particularly in the last half century. Thus, the average modern American, European, or even modern Indian or Chinese woman does not usually contemplate having children nowadays until she's in her late 20s or 30s or even 40s. When China, several decades ago, recognized their overpopulation problem and passed a law in the 1970s that couples could not get married until age 26, their infertility rate went from 1% to 12%. Putting off getting pregnant, even in your 20s, dramatically decreases the chance of you being fertile. And by their late 30s, most women are infertile. So we know that this is true in any culture, anywhere around the world, that menopause on average occurs at age 51. In some women, in any culture, it'll occur very early, like age 20 or 25. In other women, maybe age 60. There's a huge variation in your ovarian reserve. There's a huge variation in your where you are in your biologic clock. And if you know where you are, you can plan your life better. Now, here is a diagram of the human chromosomes. As you may know, we have 22 autosomes, and then we have either an X and a Y if we're a male, or two X's if we're a female. So basically, 24 different chromosomes, but it's 23 pairs of chromosomes. Now, you have to have this exact number. If the egg or the sperm unite so that you have an extra chromosome or a missing chromosome, then it's really not compatible with life or normal life. And it leads either to a miscarriage, to not getting pregnant, or in the extreme case where it's an extra copy of chromosome 21, to a Down syndrome. But it's all a different expression of the same phenomenon, a chromosomal abnormality. Now, here you'll see better what I'm talking about. Above is a normal human set of chromosomes, 22 pairs of autosomes and an X and a Y. It's a male. But you see in the Down syndrome case, below on the bottom, there are three copies in that square of chromosome 21. And so when you have an extra copy of a chromosome, or you're missing a copy of a chromosome, then that means too many or too few genes and it screws everything up. Down syndrome, it's such a small gene with so few, it's such a small chromosome with so few genes on it that it's actually compatible with life in 20% of cases, but it's an abnormality. But 80% of Down syndrome are also miscarried. And you see all these other chromosomes, if they're not arranged exactly right, if there's a genetic error in the egg, then that can't be a viable embryo, and it can't result in life. So what happens here, when the egg is maturing, and this diagram may be a little hard to follow, but when the, and this is from a textbook that I wrote, so it's not exactly designed for consumers, but nonetheless, you might get an idea. When the egg is normally maturing, chromosomes will split off so that every cell in your body has 46 chromosomes. But when that egg matures, it splits in half, so you only have 23 chromosomes. And then the sperm does the same thing. So you have a sperm with 23 chromosomes meeting an egg with 23 chromosomes, and you wind up with a fertilized egg or an embryo that has the normal number of 46 chromosomes, like every cell in your body. Now, if you have 47 chromosomes or 45 chromosomes instead of the normal 46, it's not compatible with life. And you either are infertile because that egg never develops or implants, or if it does develop or implant, it results in a miscarriage because it was never normal to start with. Now, here's the point. As your eggs get older, there's a greater and greater likelihood that as they mature and prepare for ovulation, these chromosomes don't split equally. And you basically have an abnormal egg that's programmed for death and can't result in pregnancy. That is one of the reasons why you become infertile as you get older. Your eggs age. And here's just a simple graph showing that the chance of getting pregnant goes down as you get older as the abnormality frequency in the eggs increase.